667 years ago, in October 1347, 12 Genoese trading ships docked at the Sicilian port of Messina after a long journey through the Black Sea. The people who gathered on the docks to greet them were met with a horrible surprise. Most of the sailors were dead, and those who were still alive were feverish, nauseated, and delirious from pain. Strangest of all, they were covered in mysterious black boils that oozed blood and pus. The authorities quickly ordered the ships out of the harbor, but it was too late. The Black Death had arrived in Europe. Over the next 5 years, the disease would kill over 20 million people on the continent, claiming a third of Europe's entire population.
In fact, some historians estimate that that number could have been as high as 50 million, but medieval records are sparse, so it's difficult to know. What we do know is that in cities like Florence, Paris, and Venice, the death toll was as high as 60%. The devastation was absolute. But what is this thing that we call the Black Death, which incidentally is only a term that refers to the 14th century outbreak and not subsequent outbreaks in the 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries? Scientists believe that the pandemic was caused by Yersinia pestis, a bacterium that can live in both humans as well as animals. Why pestis takes on three different forms. The first is the one that we know probably the most, which is bubonic plague. And that happens when the bacteria infects the lymph nodes and causes them to swell and to hemorrhage. This creates the telltale buboes, or boils, all over the body that give bubonic plague its name. Now, sometimes the lymph nodes become overwhelmed and they begin draining into the blood vessel system. This causes secondary septicemic plague, and it is highly deadly. The symptoms include coughing up blood, bleeding underneath the skin, and when these symptoms appear, death can follow very shortly after, within hours. The third way that Yersinia pestis can manifest itself is in the lungs. This is called pneumonic plague, and it is highly contagious because the patient begins coughing up the bacteria and passing it on to other people who breathe it, and so it quickly spreads from person to person. Pneumonic plague is really insidious because it develops just like any other respiratory illness, except that it kills you within 1 to 6 days. If left untreated, pneumonic plague is 100% fatal. But plague isn't just from olden times. People still catch it today. In fact, one of the latest outbreaks was on July 22nd of this year in Yumen, China. A man caught a rat, chopped it up, and fed it to his dog, and subsequently caught bubonic plague. He died a few days later, and the government responded by sealing off Yumen and all its 30,000 inhabitants. Probably one of the most iconic symbols of the disease is the plague doctor's mask. Bucket, can you do the honors? Ah, there we go. Thanks, Bucket. So this is a replica of a plague mask, and a lot of people believe that this is medieval thanks to contemporary accounts, such as 9/10 The Slider by our director Alex Anstey.
Available on Amazon.co.uk.
Get out of here. Get out. As well as Dan Brown's Inferno. But actually, this mask didn't exist till the 17th century, when a man named Charles Delorme invented it. He was the chief physician to Louis XIII. So the thinking behind the mask was that medical practitioners in the past believed that bad odors or poisonous vapors called miasma caused disease. Essentially, if you breathed in the plague, you would catch it. So what they did was they stuffed sweet-smelling herbs or strong-smelling herbs into the bottom of the beak, and this would protect the doctor from the bad odors or the plague. The other thing that you'll see the plague doctor wearing is a long overcoat, breeches, and gloves that were dipped in wax. This was used as an extra protectant against the plague. The other thing he might be wearing is a hat. Now, the hat isn't part of the plague doctor's outfit per se. It's just symbolic of his position as a physician in the city and as a medical practitioner. That guy. Where was I? Oh yes, he also carried a cane, and you'll see this in a lot of illustrations. Now the cane, a lot of people believe, was swung at rats to get them out of the way, but actually it was probably used to direct patients to get them to turn over or to get their families to turn them over so that the plague doctor never had to touch the plague victim. They may also stuff herbs in the bottom of the cane and swing this before them as they walk through the city, and that way it would purify the air before them. Now, when I talk to a lot of people about the plague doctor, they say, it must have been so terrifying to see this coming into your house as you were dying. And while that's true, I always remind them that we have a modern day equivalent, the hazmat uniform, which you've probably seen on the news with the Ebola outbreak. For me, I think that's probably just as terrifying to people today as this was to people in the past. Oh, okay. So what actually went into the beak? Welcome to my plague pantry. So records, unfortunately, are really vague, and this is kind of the bane of my existence as a historian. Records are vague. But what we know is that the herbs would have had to be very strong or sweet smelling to mask the odor of the plague. So things like garlic, cinnamon sticks, mint, and rosemary, cloves, and bay leaves. And give it a good shake. And there you have it, the plague mask. What? Put it on? Okay. Oh, this isn't so bad. Actually smells quite nice. Achoo!
Ugh, I can't work under these conditions.